We are thankful for dads. We are thankful for who they are. And we are thankful that before anyone is a dad, they're a son. We are your children through faith in Jesus Christ. That primarily is our identity. That primarily is our hope. And so we praise you and thank you for that. Bless us now as we study your word, and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I do want to say to all the fellows in the room, happy Father's Day. I'm glad that you're here, and I'm glad for who you are and the blessing that you are. Pastor mentioned this in worship. For some folks, Father's Day is a really good day. For other folks, Father's Day is a little bit more of a tough day. And so if you're having a great day, happy Father's Day to you. If you're having more of a tough day, maybe you don't have the best relationship in the world with your father, maybe there's some brokenness and some hurt and resentment and regret there, we want you to know that we love you and we care for you, and we want to wish you a happy Father's Day as well. If I can take a little privilege, share a little bit of personal news, this Father's Day is kind of special for me because Tuesday morning at 9:32 a.m., Hayden Christopher was born, and so I've gone from being a daddy of one to a daddy of two. And I think the person who's the happiest is Hope. She likes being a big sister, and she is already babying our baby. And so pretty soon she'll be babysitting our baby, and it'll be really good. So we are a happy family. It's kind of a special Father's Day for me and for our family. You know, right now, both in worship and in ABC, we're in this series. It's called Virtuoso, and we're talking about how we can become virtuosos of virtue. Because one of the things that we are called to be as Christians are virtuous people. And so we're taking a look at what is perhaps the most famous list of virtues in all of history in this series. It's a list of virtues in Galatians 5. The Apostle Paul calls this list the fruit of the Spirit, and he says the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Paul says these are the virtues to which every Christian ought to aspire. Now, some people will tell you that if you want to become really good at this list of virtues, here's what you need to do. You need to try harder. You got to apply more spiritual elbow grease. You got to work really hard at becoming more loving or more joyful or more peaceful or more whatever. But as we're learning in this series, the way to become a virtuoso at virtue is not to try harder. Because no matter how hard you try, you will not become good enough at being virtuous. The way to become virtuous in truth is to ask for help. To ask for the Spirit's help. To ask for God's help. That's why Paul doesn't call this a list of virtues for us to do. He calls it the fruit of the Spirit, because finally and ultimately, love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and faithfulness and gentleness and self-control, these are the works of the Spirit, and the works of the Spirit are produced in us and through us. We cannot produce these things by ourselves by means of our own spiritual moxie. And so today, as we continue, we're going to be taking a look at the fruits of faithfulness. Now, faithfulness is a pretty big deal in the Bible. One of the things that we are called to be over and over again in the pages of Scripture is faithful. Deuteronomy 28, verse 1. If you faithfully obey the voice of the Lord your God, being careful to do all his commandments that I command you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations of the earth. Proverbs 3, verse 3, let love and faithfulness never leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart. Luke 16, verse 12, Jesus says, if you have not been faithful in that which is in others, who will give you that which is your own? Faithfulness is one of those things that pops up over and over again in the Scriptures. We are called to be faithful in our obedience to God. We are called to be faithful in our everyday lives. We are called to be faithful stewards of what God has given to us. We are called to be faithful. Now, Greek word for faithful, for faithfulness, is the word pistis. And what's interesting about the word pistis is that in the New Testament, this is not only the word for faithfulness, this is simply the word for faith. It can be translated both ways. Romans 1, verse 17. In the gospel, a righteousness from God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith, that is by pistis, from the first to the last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith, by pistis. Ephesians 2, verses 8 and 9, for it is by grace you have been saved through pistis, through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works so that no one can boast. Romans 3, verse 22, righteousness from God comes through pistis, comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. Now, right out of the chute, this leads us to a very important realization about faithfulness. Faithfulness and faith go hand in hand. In the New Testament, in Greek, they're both the same word. You need both. You cannot have faithfulness without faith, and faith without faithfulness. This is especially true when it comes to the nature and the character of God. One of the great promises that we have about our God is that He is faithful. He always keeps His word. He always keeps His promises. If we did not have a God who was faithful, if He broke His word, if He did not keep His promises, we would be, well, we would be destroyed. And yet, faithfulness doesn't do us a lot of good if we don't trust, if we don't have faith in His faithfulness. Because that is how we are saved, when we have faith in the faithfulness of God who always keeps His promises. You see, both are needed, faithfulness and faith. Now, one other thing that I want you to know, just by way of introduction to this whole topic of faithfulness. A lot of times when it comes to faithfulness, it's kind of painted in terms of standing firm in the midst of opposition and persecution. In other words, when somebody does something really, really wrong, we think of faithfulness as us standing up for what is really, really right. And in one sense, that is absolutely true. Faithfulness calls us to stand up for what is right in the midst of what is wrong. Think of the stories in the book of Daniel. Here's Daniel. He's under the rule and reign of a guy named Darius. Darius issues an edict that anybody who prays to anything other than him for 30 days is going to be thrown into a lion's den. What does Daniel do? Does he pray to Darius or does he pray to God? He prays to God. And where does he wind up? In a lion's den. That is faithfulness. Daniel refuses to do what is wrong. Instead, he stands up for what is right. Daniel's friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. There's another king. His name is Nebuchadnezzar. He builds a big statue, and he commands everybody in the kingdom to bow down and to worship the statue. Nebuchadnezzar says, if you do not do so, you will be thrown into a fiery furnace. Now, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they got a choice to make. Do they go for the fiery furnace? Or do they bow down to a false statue that is not a real God? Which one do Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego choose? The false statue or the fiery furnace? They go for the fiery furnace. Because they stand up for what is right in the midst of what is wrong. And this is part of faithfulness. It is standing up for what is right in the midst of what is wrong. Faithfulness is bold and brassy and brazen. But that's not all. Faithfulness is. You know, I find it very instructive the way that Paul orders his list of the fruit of the Spirit. He says the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness. Anybody remember what comes after faithfulness? Gentleness. And this is important because here's the deal. If you have a lot of faithfulness, but you don't have any gentleness, here's what can happen. You can wind up being real self-righteous and real arrogant. But then again, if you have a lot of gentleness and you don't have a lot of faithfulness, quite frankly, you can wind up being kind of a wimp because you refuse to have a tough conversation even when that tough conversation needs to be had. Here's the deal. Faithfulness helps you keep the truth so you don't sell out. Gentleness helps you keep your decorum so you don't turn into a jerk. You need both. Now, what I love about Jesus is that he exemplifies this perfectly. He's faithful, but he's also gentle. On the one hand, Jesus is not afraid to call out people in their sin, for their sin, and because of their sin. This is why he will talk to the religious leaders like this. Matthew 23, verse 13. Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you're hypocrites. You shut the kingdom of heaven in men's faces. You yourselves do not enter, nor will you let those enter who are trying to. Jesus is not afraid, faithfully, to take it to the Pharisees. But even though Jesus can be really brassy, really brazen, and really bold, there are also times where Jesus is really gentle, even to the Pharisees. Jesus tells this parable one day about two sons. One son goes to his father one day, and he says to his dad, "Dad, I'm kind of sick and tired of you. I'd like to set out on my own, do my own thing, be my own man. Give me my share of the inheritance right now." And the father does, and the son goes off, and he blows the money on wild living. He winds up dirt poor and broke because once the money is gone, his friends are gone too. Has to go out and get a day job feeding pigs where he is starving to death, and he knows that he only has one option, which is to come groveling back to his dad. And so that's what the son does. He comes groveling back to his dad, but his dad, rather than being angry at this son, is forgiving of this son, and he throws for this son a giant party because he is so happy that the son of his, who was lost, is now found. But there's another son in this story, an older son, by all accounts a better son. Because this son is the son who sticks around. This son is the son who doesn't sell his father out. This son is the son who helps his father even when his younger brother has left. And when this younger brother returns, and when this younger brother gets a big party, you know what happens to the older son? He begins to get a little jealous. In fact, he begins not only to get jealous, he begins to get mad. And when he sees that his dad has thrown this little brat a big party, he refuses to go into the party. The way Jesus tells it is like this, Luke 15, verse 28. The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out, and I want you to catch this word, and pleaded with him. But the older son answered his father, "Look, all these years I've been slaving for you. I've never disobeyed your orders. You never even gave me a young goat so that I could celebrate with my friends." You see, this older son is real upset with his father. He speaks disrespectfully to his father. But notice what the father does. He's gentle with the younger son. He forgives the younger son when he comes back. But he's also gentle with the older son. How do we know? Because rather than smacking him around and saying, "Hey, don't be such an arrogant, self-righteous jerk," he goes outside to the older son and he pleads with him. He begs him to come and join the joy. He begs him to come and join the party. Now, what's really instructive about this particular story is who this story is told to. Luke 15, beginning at verse 1. Now, the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners, and he eats with them." He, like, parties with them. We don't like this guy. And so what Jesus does is he tells a story. It's actually a parable. And a parable is a story, a simple story, that is meant to teach a profound truth to two different groups of people. One group of people who are rebellious, who are tax collectors and sinners, who like to go out and squander money and live wild lives and break lots of laws, just like the younger son. But he also tells the story to Pharisees and teachers of the law, people who like to keep the law and always do the right thing and never break faith with God. They want to make sure all their theological I's are dotted and T's are crossed. And boy, oh boy, they don't like all those rebellious people. Just like the older brother. And so what does Jesus do with older brothers? What does Jesus do with even the likes of Pharisees and teachers of the law? He goes forth and he pleads with them. He invites them to come and join the joy. He's faithful with them. He calls them out on their sin. He doesn't let them get away. He knows how to be tough when he's called to be tough, but he also knows how to plead. He also knows how to be gentle when he needs to be gentle. You see, you need both to get both right. And it's this that takes us to our story for today. Today we're going to be looking at a whole book of the Old Testament. We'll be done about 1:30 this afternoon. That's my Father's Day gift to you. No, I'm kidding. We're going to be taking a look at a whole book in the Old Testament, the book of Esther. Now, here's what you need to know, okay? This book is a negative example. This book is not so much an example of lots of people who are really faithful. This book is really more of a story of a bunch of people who are really faithless. And so we're going to be learning by a negative example, not by a positive one. Now, just by way of a little bit of background here for you, in 586 BC, the Babylonians, they come in and they sweep into the southern half of Israel and they conquer the southern half of Israel and the city of Jerusalem. They sack the temple in the city of Jerusalem, and they destroy the temple in the city of Jerusalem. And all the people who are living in Jerusalem and the surrounding areas, all the Jews, they carry off all of those people into exile in the nation of Babylon. Now, the Jews live in Babylon in exile, away from their homeland, for 48 years until the Babylonians are conquered by the Persians. And there's a guy named Cyrus. In 538 BC, he issues a decree that all of the Jews who are hanging out in Babylon can finally go home and go back to the city of Jerusalem. And a lot of the Jews do. But some of the Jews, they've kind of set up shop in Babylon. They've set up shop in what is now the newly minted kingdom of Persia. And they don't really want to uproot their families. They don't really want to uproot their homes. They don't really want to uproot their lives. And so rather than going back to their historical home, they decide that they're going to stay in their current home. And this takes us to the book of Esther. Because the book of Esther is about those Jews. Those Jews who stayed in the kingdom of Persia. Now, the guy who's on the throne in the kingdom of Persia by the time we get to the book of Esther is a guy named Xerxes. And when Xerxes comes to power, things begin to get a little bit dicey for the Jews who are living in his kingdom. And so if you've got a Bible, open up to the very beginning of the book, Esther 1, beginning at verse 1. Esther 1, beginning at verse 1, and we're going to try to get through a bunch of this book together. Esther 1, beginning at verse 1. And this is what happened during the time of Xerxes, the Xerxes who ruled over 127 provinces. By the way, make a note of that. That'll become important a little bit later. 127 provinces stretching from India to Kush. At that time, King Xerxes reigned from his royal throne in the citadel of Susa. And in the third year of his reign, he gave a banquet for all of his nobles and officials. The military leaders of Persia and Media, the princes and the nobles of the provinces were present. For a full 180 days, he displayed the vast wealth of his kingdom and the splendor and the glory of his majesty. Book of Esther, it opens with a party. Verse 3 says that Xerxes, the king of Persia, decides that he is going to give a banquet for all of his nobles and officials. A quick note on the Hebrew here. The Hebrew word for banquet is the word mishteth. This is actually a technical term for a specific kind of banquet. This is not just any old kind of banquet. This is a banquet with a lot of booze. King Xerxes, the best way to put it, is throwing a giant kegger. Now notice how long the kegger lasts for. Verse 4 says that it goes on for how long? 180 days. That's six straight months of Miller time, okay? There's like some serious debauchery going on right at the beginning of this story. Now, after six straight months of this kegger, King Xerxes gets an idea. Esther 1 verse 10. When King Xerxes was in high spirits from wine, I'll say, he commanded the seven eunuchs who served him. Mehuman, Biztha, Harbona, Bigtha, Abegatha, Zethar, and Carcass to bring before him Queen Vashti, wearing her royal crown, in order to display her beauty to the people and nobles, for she was lovely to look at. But when the attendants delivered the king's command, Queen Vashti refused to come. Here's what happens. The king gets drunk and asks for the queen. Now, notice why. He asks for the queen. King Xerxes does not ask for Queen Vashti to come and have a deep conversation about politics or religion. He does not ask her to come and display some works of art from her royal art collection or to give a concert because she's a very talented musician. No, he does not request her to come because of her brains, her talent, or her sweet disposition. He asks her to come, verse 11 says, because why? She was lovely to look at. Here's the idea. King Xerxes has a bunch of his buddies over for 6 months of Miller time. They are all drunk, and now they want to ogle a beautiful woman. Can you believe that there was ever a society that was so debased and so depraved that would have guys who would get drunk and then want to look at beautiful women? That never happens today. But way back then, that kind of stuff actually happened. Now, Vashti, Queen Vashti, she's not buying it. Verse 12 says that Queen Vashti refused to come. Now think about this. You're the king. You're with all your buddies. You're having a big party. And you ask the queen to come on in and parade around. And the queen says, you know what? I'm watching reruns of Everybody Loves Raymond tonight. Thanks, but no thanks. I'm not going to come, and I'm not going to be a little show for you and your buddies. How do you think the king is going to respond to this? Real well or not so well? Not so well. This is kind of a wound to his machismo. His ego is very dinged. And so here is what Xerxes does. He issues a decree, Esther 1 verse 19, that Vashti is never again to enter the presence of King Xerxes. In other words, he deposes the queen. But now that he's deposed the queen, King Xerxes, king of Persia, has a problem. Because what's a king without a queen? He needs another pretty girl on his arm. And so he launches a search. Esther 2 verse 2 now. Then the king's personal attendants proposed, let a search be made for beautiful young virgins for the king. Let the king appoint commissioners in every province of his realm to bring all these beautiful girls into the harem at the citadel of Susa. Let them be placed under the care of Haggai, the king's eunuch, who is in charge of the women, and let beauty treatments be given to them. Then let the girl who pleases the king be queen instead of Vashti. This advice appealed to the king, and he followed it. King Xerxes gets all of his advisors together, and he says, what should I do? Now, verse 2 of Esther 2 says that the king's personal attendants made a proposal. Another bit of Hebrew here for you. The Hebrew word for personal attendants is the word na'ar. This is a word that is used to describe young men. And so here's what King Xerxes does. When he's looking for a new wife, he doesn't turn to old and seasoned and wise godly men. He turns to young men. And young men give him advice that has to do with a queen. They have one criterion for what this queen should be. It comes up over and over again in verses 2 and 3. Let a search be made for beautiful young virgins for the king, they say. Let the king appoint commissioners in every province of his realm to bring all these beautiful girls into the harem at the citadel of Susa. What's the one criterion for the new queen? Whether or not she is beautiful. It's all about her looks. Just find the prettiest girl out there, Xerxes, and she can be the queen. And so these young men, they gather up girls, verse 3 says, from every province. Now remember, back in chapter 1, verse 1, how many provinces does Xerxes have? 127. That means that at least 127 beautiful girls are being paraded before Xerxes to see which girl is going to become his queen. This is like five seasons of The Bachelor rolled into one, okay? Esther 2, verse 8. When the king's order and edict had been proclaimed, many girls were brought to the citadel of Susa and put under the care of Haggai. Esther. Here's the main character of the book. Esther also was taken to the king's palace and entrusted to Haggai, who had charge of the harem. The girl pleased him and won his favor. Immediately, he provided her with beauty treatments and special food. He assigned to her 7 maids and selected from the king's palace and moved her and her maids into the best place in the harem. Esther had not revealed her nationality and her family background because Mordecai had forbidden her to do so. Every day, Mordecai would walk back and forth near the courtyard of the harem to find out how Esther was and what was happening to her. Before a girl's turn came to go into King Xerxes, she had to complete, notice this, 12 months of beauty treatments. Guys, sometimes you may think, my wife takes an awfully long time to get ready in the morning. You got nothing over on these girls. 12 months of beauty treatments prescribed for the women. 6 months with oil of myrrh, and 6 with perfumes and cosmetics. Now, in these verses, we're introduced to two of the major characters in the book of Esther. One is Esther herself. We're going to be talking about her. But the other guy that I want you to pick up on is this guy named Mordecai. Verse 11, we are introduced to him. And here's what you need to know about Mordecai. Mordecai is Esther's cousin. And as Esther's cousin, Mordecai keeps a close watch on Esther to see how she is doing in this giant beauty pageant that King Xerxes is having. Verse 11 says that every day he would walk back and forth near the courtyard of the harem to find out how Esther was and what was happening to her. In other words, Mordecai seems to be watching out for his family. He wants to help Esther get in good with the king. And you know what? Esther does get in good with the king. Verse 17 of Esther 2. Now the king was attracted to Esther more than any of the other women. And she won his favor and approval more than any of the other virgins. So, he set a royal crown on her head. And she gets to become queen in place of Vashti. And the king gave a great banquet, Esther's banquet, for all his nobles and officials. He proclaimed a holiday throughout the provinces and distributed gifts with royal liberality. Esther, after the nationwide search from all these provinces, all these women, Esther wins the contest. Esther becomes the beauty pageant queen. Esther becomes the queen of Persia. But here's what I want you to notice. I want you to notice what she had to do to get there. A couple of things that are real key. Verse 10 of Esther 2 says that Esther had not revealed her nationality. In other words, King Xerxes, her new husband, doesn't know that she's a Jew. Doesn't know that she worships the God of Israel. Doesn't know about her faith. Doesn't know about her trust in the one who made the heavens and the earth. It's not like they're holding hands and going to church on Sunday morning. He doesn't even know where she's from or what she believes. Esther has to downplay her background, downplay her nationality, and by that, downplay her faith to become the queen. She hides her faith. The other thing she does, very interesting, verse 12, before a girl's turn, came to go in to King Xerxes. I want you to pick up on that phrase, to go in to King Xerxes. That's a euphemism for something. And I'll just put it this way. She wasn't exactly pure, or she didn't keep the promise that she should have before she got married. In other words, in order to get the king, she decides to give herself to the king in a way that is inappropriate. You know, so often we assume that because Esther was a Jew who became a queen, she was a real faithful woman and God was just blessing her for her faithfulness. She was super faithful and God blessed her. But if you really stop to consider the story, that's not really totally the case. Esther compromised to become queen. She hid her faith. She gave of herself in a way that she should not give of herself before she is married. And yet it's amazing, as we're going to see, even though Esther acts in some faithless ways, God is faithful. Esther 3, verse 1 now. After these events, King Xerxes honored Haman, son of Hammedatha, the Agagite, elevating him and giving him a seat of honor higher than all of the other nobles. All the royal officials at the king's gate knelt down and paid honor to Haman, for the king had commanded this concerning him. But Mordecai would not kneel down or pay him honor. Then the royal officials at the king's gate asked Mordecai, "Why do you disobey the king's command?" Day after day they spoke to him, but he refused to comply. Therefore they told Haman about it to see whether Mordecai's behavior would be tolerated, for he had told them that he was a Jew. When Haman saw that Mordecai would not kneel down or pay him honor, he was enraged. Yet having learned who Mordecai's people were, he scorned the idea of killing only Mordecai. Instead, Haman looked for a way to destroy all of Mordecai's people, the Jews, throughout the whole kingdom of Xerxes. Now here in Esther 3, we are introduced to kind of the final main character of the story of Esther. This is a guy named Haman. Now part of what's fascinating about Haman is that Haman pretty much comes out of nowhere. We don't really get a lot of background about Haman. We don't know really about his nationality. We don't really know what he's done. Verse 1 says that the king Xerxes honored Haman. He elevated him. He gave him a seat of honor higher than all of the other nobles. But it never tells us why he was honored. There's no achievement, no honorable deed, no valiant act that is mentioned. He's just promoted for no apparent reason. Now, because Haman becomes a bigwig in the kingdom of Persia, Haman feels the need to assert his authority. He wants everybody to bow down to him. And so the king issues a decree that when you see Haman, you got to reverence him. When you see Haman, you got to bow. And everybody does. Verse 2 of Esther 3, all the royal officials at the king's gate knelt down and paid honor to Haman. Everybody bows down except for one man. Esther's cousin, Mordecai. And we're not given a specific reason as to why Mordecai didn't bow down before Haman, but this much we do know, when Mordecai doesn't bow down before Haman, Haman does not like it. Verse 5 says that he was enraged. In fact, he was so enraged that when he learned who Mordecai's people were, he didn't just want to kill Mordecai, he wanted to destroy all of Mordecai's people, the Jews, throughout the whole kingdom of Xerxes. Now, just to make sure you don't miss this, okay? Mordecai is a Jew. Esther is his cousin. Which means that Esther is also a Jew. Who does Haman want to destroy? Not just Mordecai, but all of the Jews. And so now, not only does Mordecai have trouble, Esther has trouble. The queen herself could find herself in some very hot water. Haman, what he does is he hatches a plot to try to get rid of not only Mordecai, but all of Mordecai's people. And the plot that he hatches is really quite ingenious. It's pretty conniving. Esther 3, verse 8, what Haman does is he goes into the king, and he has a conversation with the king, and this is what he says. There's a certain people dispersed and scattered among the peoples in all the provinces of your kingdom, whose customs are different from those of all the other people, and who do not obey the king's laws. It is not in the king's best interest to tolerate them. If it pleases the king, let a decree be issued to destroy them. And I'm going to put 10,000 talents of silver into the royal treasury for the men who carry out this business. So the king took a signet ring from his finger, gave it to Haman, son of Hammedatha, the Agagite, the enemy of the Jews. "Keep the money," the king said to Haman, "and do with these people as you please." Now, three things here that I want you to notice about this exchange between King Xerxes and Haman. First, I want you to notice that when Haman goes into King Xerxes, he never actually tells King Xerxes what people group he is mad at. He simply says in verse 8, there is a certain people whose customs are different from those of all the other people who do not obey the king's laws. The Persian kingdom had lots of different peoples. Haman never says, "Hey, I got a problem with the Jews." He simply says there's a certain people who is causing some trouble. Second thing that I want you to notice is what Haman says to the king in verse 9. He says, if it pleases the king, let a decree be issued to destroy them. Now, this is important. The Hebrew word for destroy here is the word avad. Now, avad is a word that can also mean enslave. In fact, these two words, one word for destroy, which is kill, the other word for enslave, they're both avad, but they're spelled a little bit differently, but they sound exactly the same. And so there's probably a pretty good chance when Haman goes into the king and says, hey, I want to avad these people, the king is probably thinking, oh yeah, let's enslave the people. He's probably not thinking, let's destroy the people. And so Haman's being very sneaky here. Third thing that I want you to notice is what Haman does to try to get this job done. The king gives, or Haman gives to the king 10,000 talents of silver. You know what that's called? A bribe. Now, Pastor mentioned this in his message, just so you kind of get a lay of the land here. This amount of silver is roughly equivalent to about $211 million in today's currency. And so not only is it a bribe, it's a very handsome bribe. And you know what? The king falls for Haman's plot and ploy. In verse 11, he says to Haman, hey, you can do with the people as you please. Now, word gets back to Mordecai as to what has happened with Haman and King Xerxes. And Mordecai, well, he kind of melts down. Esther 4, verse 1, when Mordecai learned of all that had been done, he tore his clothes, put on sackcloth and ashes, and he went out into the city. He was wailing loudly and bitterly. Mordecai knows that his goose is cooked. Mordecai knows that he is fixing to hit the end of the road. Mordecai knows that if something doesn't change, he is going to be slaughtered under this man, Haman, who he knows hates him because he will not bow to him. And so what Mordecai does is he turns to the only person he can, who can maybe be in a position to rescue him and to rescue the Jews. He turns to his cousin Esther. And he sends her a message explaining everything that has happened. And this is Esther's response to Mordecai's message. Verse 11 of Esther 4, all the king's officials and the people of the royal provinces know that for any man or woman who approaches the king in the inner court without being summoned, the king has but one law, that he be put to death. The only exception to this is for the king to extend the golden scepter to him and spare his life. But 30 days have passed since I was called to go to the king. May I just suggest that if you're a wife and you don't see your husband for 30 days, when you live in the same house, maybe you need to see a marriage counselor, okay? I mean, clearly, Esther and Xerxes, they do not have a very healthy marriage. But here's what I also want you to notice. Esther's not being very faithful here. In fact, she's being kind of a coward. She knows that if she goes into the king and she asks a big favor from the king, she could get in trouble with the king. And she doesn't want to do that. She didn't want to rescue her people. She didn't want to stand up for her faith. She doesn't want to march forth in the name of the Lord. And so what Mordecai has to do is he has to do a little arm twisting here. Esther 4, verse 13, Mordecai replies, do not think that because you're in the king's house, you alone of all the Jews will escape. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place, but you and your families, or father's family, will perish. And who knows but that you have come to a royal position for such a time as this. Then Esther sent this reply to Mordecai, go, gather together all the Jews who are in Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my maids will fast as you do, and when this is done, I'll go into the king, even though it is against the law. And then I love this last line, if I perish, I perish. Finally, little Esther, who's been very timid up to this point, who has hidden her faith, who has betrayed what she knows to be right and true, finally Esther decides that she's going to trade that in for faithfulness. She decides that even if it costs her her life, she's going to try to do the right thing rather than the easy thing. It takes a little while for her to get there, but when she does, what happens is amazing. Esther 5, verse 1. On the third day, Esther put on her royal robes and stood in the inner court of the palace in front of the king's hall. The king was sitting on his royal throne in the hall facing the entrance. When he saw Queen Esther standing in the court, he was pleased with her, and he held out to her the golden scepter that was in his hand. Whew! Crossed one barrier, right? She's not immediately going to be killed by the king because she went to go see, I don't know, her husband, okay? So Esther approached and touched the tip of the scepter. Then the king asked, "What is it, Queen Esther? What is your request? Even up to half the kingdom, it's going to be given to you." Now, you need to know, this is a little bit of royal hyperbole. When King Xerxes sees Queen Esther and says, "Ah, sweetie, what do you need? Even up to half the kingdom, it's going to be given to you." If Esther would have responded, "Okay, I would like half the kingdom," the king's disposition would have changed radically and quickly. He's in a good mood, and he's willing to be generous, but he's not willing to be that generous. It's kind of like a while back, a buddy of mine had a birthday, and I offered to take him to lunch, and I said, "Where would you like to go? We can go anywhere. It's on me." And so my buddy said, "I'd like to go to Ruth's Chris Steakhouse." And I said, "How about Taco Cabana?" You see, I was willing to be generous, but I didn't want to be that generous. That's what's going on here. This is some royal hyperbole. But here's the problem. Even if Esther doesn't want half the kingdom, she has a big request, a huge request to save a whole group of people. And this request could indeed anger the king, because it's going to take a lot of maneuvering. It's going to take a lot of work to save the Jews. And so what she does is she kind of goes back to playing it a little sly and a little safe. Rather than just making a request of the king outright, she issues an invitation. Esther 5, verse 4. "If it pleases the king," replied Esther, "let the king, together with Haman, come today to a banquet that I prepared for him." The king says yes. Haman and the king show up at the banquet. And the king says again, Esther 5, verse 6, "Now what is your petition? It's going to be given to you. What is your request? Even up to half the kingdom, it's going to be granted." Esther replied, "My petition and my request is this: if the king regards me with favor, and if it pleases the king to grant my petition and fulfill my request, let the king and Haman come tomorrow to another banquet that I will prepare for them. And then I'll make my request. Then I'll answer the king's question." The old saying goes, the best way to a man's heart is through his what? Yeah, Esther knows it. So she throws the king not one, but two banquets. And Haman is going to be there for both of them. In fact, when Haman gets his invitation to the second banquet, Haman's ecstatic. Esther 5, verse 9, "Haman went out that day happy and in high spirits. But when he saw Mordecai at the king's gate and observed that he neither rose nor showed fear in his presence, he was filled with rage against Mordecai. Nevertheless, Haman restrained himself and went home. Calling together his friends and Zeresh, his wife, Haman boasted to them about his vast wealth, his many sons, and all the ways the king had honored him and how he had elevated him above all the other nobles and officials. 'And that's not all,' Haman added. 'I'm the only person Queen Esther has invited to accompany the king to a banquet that she gave. And she's invited me along with the king tomorrow, too. But all this gives me no satisfaction as long as I see that Jew Mordecai sitting at the king's gate.' His wife Zeresh and all his friends said to him, 'Have a gallows built 75 feet high, and ask the king in the morning to have Mordecai hanged on it. Then go with the king to the dinner and be happy.' This suggestion delighted Haman, and he had the gallows built." Now, just so you have a little point of comparison here, Haman builds these gallows that are 75 feet high. If you walk through our sanctuary, on the side walls, you'll notice these big pillars that actually hold up the trusses for the roof of the sanctuary, those are 55 feet high. Think about that. Haman builds gallows that are 20 feet higher than the pillars on the side that hold up our sanctuary. You know what this is called? Overkill. I mean, Haman's rage has blinded him to any sort of reasonableness in his dealings with Mordecai. In fact, the only thing that is bigger than Haman's rage is Haman's ego. Because he thinks he's the cat's meow. He's the king's right-hand man. And now he's been invited to eat with the queen. Verse 12, he says to his family, I'm the only person Queen Esther invited to accompany the king to the banquet she gave, and she's invited me to go along with the king tomorrow. And I'm pretty sure he said it in that tone of voice. I mean, he has a huge ego problem. But little does Haman know that what Esther is really doing is setting a trap. Esther 7, verse 1 now. So the king and Haman went to dine with Queen Esther. And as they were drinking wine on the second day, the king again asked, Queen Esther, what is your petition? It's going to be given to you. What is your request? Even up to half the kingdom, it's going to be granted. Then Queen Esther answered, If I found favor with you, O king, and if it pleases your majesty, here's the request. Grant me my life and spare my people. For I and my people have been sold for destruction and slaughter and annihilation. If we had merely been sold as male and female slaves, which is probably what King Xerxes thought was happening, I would have kept quiet because no such distress would have justified disturbing the king. King Xerxes asked Queen Esther, Who is he? Where is the man that has dared to do such a thing? Esther said, The adversary and enemy is the vile Haman. Then Haman was terrified before the king and the queen. The king got up in a rage, left his wine, went out into the palace garden, but Haman, realizing that the king had already decided his fate, stayed behind to beg Queen Esther for his life. Just as the king returned from the palace garden to the banquet hall, Haman was falling on the couch where Esther was reclining. And I love this picture because remember, what does Haman get so mad at Mordecai for not doing, for not falling down before him? There's this Jew who refuses to fall down before him, and now the tables are turned, and Haman has fallen down before a Jew to beg for his life. Here's the problem, right? As Haman is falling down before Esther, the king comes back in and sees what is happening, and the king doesn't see it this way. The king sees something else, something more sinister. The king exclaimed, Will he even molest the queen while she's with me in the house? As soon as the word left the king's mouth, they covered Haman's face. Then Harbona, one of the eunuchs attending the king, said, A gallows 75 feet high. Hey, what do you know? Stands by Haman's house. The king said, Hang him on it. So they hanged Haman on the gallows that he had prepared for Mordecai. And the king's fury subsided. This is called poetic justice, right? Haman prepares these gallows for Mordecai, and Haman gets the gallows instead of Mordecai. You know, one of the reasons that I like this story, and I really do like this story, but one of the reasons that I appreciate this story, and I think this story has a lot to teach us, is because it highlights two things. Number one, it highlights just how deep the faithlessness of people can run. But number two, it also highlights just how towering the faithfulness of God really is. Here's what I mean. There are a couple of characters in this story who act quite faithlessly, but they act faithlessly for a couple of different reasons. Esther, she has some faithless moments. Why? Because she is timid. She is so timid that she will not stand up for what is right. She's always scared. She's always walking on eggshells. She doesn't want to go to the king and have a conversation about saving her people. She doesn't want to reveal her nationality, her faith, and her religion that she trusts in the one true God of Israel. Just to become the queen, she will even sleep with the king before she is the queen. She is timid. She sells everything because she's always scared. Now, here's the problem with timidity. Timidity doesn't see a God who's powerful enough. Powerful enough to rescue you. Powerful enough to save you. And so timidity always worries about other people rather than trusting in God. It's faithlessness. Another faithless person in this story is Haman. Now, if Esther struggles with faithlessness because of her timidity, Haman has a faithless problem because of his pride, right? He thinks that he is the cat's meow, and he wants everybody else to know it too. In fact, there's a really interesting line in Esther 3, verse 2, when it says, "All the royal officials at the king's gate knelt down to pay honor to Haman. Why did they do so? For the king had commanded this concerning him." Now, in this day, bowing to somebody else was kind of second nature. It was kind of like a handshake in our day. Everybody would do it as a sign of simple respect and a cordial greeting. Apparently, Haman was such a jerk, he was so incorrigible, that just to get people to bow to him, the king had to issue an edict. Because Haman was pompous. Haman was proud. You know, here's one of the big problems with pride, okay? If you're proud, everybody knows it. Except you. Pride is a way of putting blinders on your own heart. You know, when Haman was so proud that Mordecai wouldn't bow down to him, and so he decides to build a gallows that's 75 feet high, he never even pauses to think, wow, this sure is insane. He just assumes he's right. And that's why pride leads to faithlessness, because pride, rather than trusting in the rightness of God, trusts in the rightness of me. I'm always right, always call the right shots, always make the right decisions. I do no wrong. I can figure this out. I can get it taken care of. That's faithlessness. You see, the people in the book of Esther do not do very well on the faithfulness scale. They're negative examples. They're not faithful. They're faithless. But at the same time, there are faithless people in the book of Esther. There's also a faithful God in the book of Esther. Except that I don't know whether or not you noticed this. God is never actually mentioned in the book of Esther. The name of God is never spoken. Nowhere in the whole book. The title of God is never mentioned. Now, you need to know this was done on purpose. It's not like the Jews who were writing this book got to the end of the book and they said, "Oh no, we forgot God." It didn't work that way. The author of Esther is actually trying to make a point about the way that God regularly works. Because God regularly works mysteriously. God regularly works hiddenly. A lot of times we read the Bible and we see these big and brassy ways that God works, right? He parts the Red Sea, sends 10 plagues on the Egyptians. He carries up Elijah into heaven in a chariot of fire, does all these miracles, all these wonders. And we kind of wonder to ourselves, well, if God worked that way in that day, why doesn't God work that way in our day? Now, the answer to the question is sometimes he does. There are still some pretty incredible stories about healings, about other things, about rescues, where the only thing that you can even come to the conclusion of is that God has somehow worked in a miraculous way. But at the same time, more often than big and brassy ways, more often than not, God works in a bunch of little hidden ways. I mean, think about this. In the book of Esther, you know how God works? You know how he works? Through a drunk king. That's how he works. Because if it wasn't for the drunk king who deposes his queen, then a door wouldn't have been opened for Esther. And if it wasn't for Esther being the favorite of that king, then she wouldn't have risen to be the queen of the kingdom. And if she had never risen to be the queen of the kingdom, when Haman hatched his plot to destroy the Jews, then there wouldn't have been someone there to step in and save the day. You see, the book of Esther is just what could be considered a series of coincidences. But when you put them all together, even though the name of God is never mentioned, you begin to see that all these coincidences are actually something more. In fact, it's interesting because at the end of the book, after the Jews have been rescued, they've been delivered from Haman's plot and ploy, they institute a festival. You know what the festival is called? Purim. Esther 9, verse 21, the Jews celebrated annually the 14th and 15th days of the month of Adar as the time when the Jews got relief from their enemies and as the month when their sorrow was turned to joy and their mourning into a day of celebration. These days were called Purim from the word pure. You know what the word pure means? It's a Babylonian word. It means a lot or a chance. It's a word that refers to good fortune. Oh, what good fortune the Jews have had that a drunk king deposed his queen, that a little Jewish girl named Esther rose through the ranks, that she became queen at just the right time when Haman was hatching an evil and vile plot for her to step in and save the day. Oh, what good pure these Jews have. What good fortune, what a good lot has been cast for them. Proverbs 16, verse 33. The lot, the pure, is cast into the lap. But its every decision is from the Lord. There's a Lord who finally oversees the lot. There's a God who finally reigns sovereign. Even over things that we see as little more than chance. He's working quietly behind the scenes to help his people, to love his people, to be faithful to his people, and ultimately to save his people. But if you don't look carefully, you might miss it. You know, I've been thinking a lot about my dad on this Father's Day. And one of the things that I respect the most was how hard he worked to make sure that I got the education that he never did. My dad was the first in his family to ever graduate from college, but college was tough for him because he didn't have the foundation of a good grade school and middle school and high school. And he wanted that for me, but we didn't have a lot of money growing up. And so he would work all these overtime hours at his job. He'd work a lot more than 40 hours a week. He'd go in on Saturdays. He'd stay late. He'd go in early just so that he could have the tuition money to send me to a private Lutheran school so that I could get the educational foundation that he never got. And I was thinking about this as a kid. I never really even noticed it or acknowledged it. I just assumed it was part of what Dad did. But now that I'm a little bit older, I appreciate all the hard work that he put in for me. You know, when Jesus came to this earth, one of the great tragedies is that so many people didn't notice all the hard work that God was doing through this carpenter's son from Nazareth. They overlooked him, they doubted him, they hated him, they plotted against him, they arrested him, they mocked him, they killed him. In other words, a lot of people missed him. But in the simplest of ways, in fact, in the most brutal of ways, God was being faithful. Sometimes God works in big, brassy, bold, and brazen ways. More often than not, though, he works in simple and subtle ways. And you know what? There's both a challenge and a promise to that. The challenge is this. Don't miss it. Because all too often we do. But the promise is this. If God works in simple ways, most of the days of our lives are simple days. Every once in a while, we got a big red letter day that we mark on the calendar that we remember, that we take pictures of, that we put in a photo album. But most days are simple days. Most days are days that are forgotten. Most days are days that fade into the recesses of our minds and of history and of time. And yet, even on the simple days, if God works in simple ways, God is still working on those days that we forget. The days that we forget, God does not. You know why? Because God is faithful. And he gives to us his faithfulness, which means that he gives to us salvation. Let's stand and pray. Heavenly Father, we are promised that you're a faithful God. And so often we miss your simple faithfulness every day of our lives. You work and you speak. You give to us your word, your son's body and blood. You give to us faith. You give to us your spirit. Father, we do pray that we wouldn't miss that, but at the same time we pray that we would just realize and recognize that even in simple ways, on simple days, you are at work. And we thank you for the great promise that that holds for our lives, even when we don't recognize it, even when we call something chance, that is really you. We thank you for your sovereignty, but we also praise you for the way in which your sovereignty works. It works by love. We thank you for loving us, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a great week. Walk with light.